So now that we have defined what neural networks are, we need to learn how to train them. Training them really means what parameters should they have on the edges in order to model our data well. So in order to learn how to train them, we need to look carefully at how they process the input to obtain an output. So let's look at our simplest neural network, a perceptron. This perceptron receives a data point of the form x1, x2, where the label is y equals 1. This means that the point is blue. Now, the perceptron is defined by a linear equation, say w1x1 plus w2x2 plus b, where w1 and w2 are the weights in the edges and b is the bias on the node. Here w1 is bigger than w2, so we'll denote that by drawing the edge labeled w1 much thicker than the edge labeled w2. Now, what the perceptron does is it plots the point x1, x2, and it outputs the probability that the point is blue. Here, since the point is in the red area, then the output is a small number, since the point is not very likely to be blue. This process is known as feed-forward. We can see that this is a bad model, because the point is actually blue, given that the third coordinate, the y, is 1. Now, if we have a more complicated neural network, then the process is the same. Here we have thick edges corresponding to large weights, and thin edges corresponding to small weights. And the neural network plots the point in the top graph and also in the bottom graph. And the outputs coming out will be a small number from the top model, since the point lies in the red area, which means it has a small probability of being blue, and a large number from the second model, since the point lies in the blue area, which means it has a large probability of being blue. Now, as the two models get combined into this nonlinear model, and the output layer just plots the point, and it tells us the probability that the point is blue. As you can see, this is a bad model because it puts the point in the red area and the point is blue. Again, this process is called feed-forward, and we'll look at it more carefully. Here we have our neural network in the other notation, so the bias is in the outside. Now we have a matrix of weights. The matrix W superscript 1 denoting the first layer, and the entries are the weights W11 up to W32. Notice that the biases have now been written as W31 and W32. This is just for convenience. Now in the next layer, we also have a matrix. This one is W superscript 2 for the second layer. This layer contains the weights that tell us how to combine the linear models in the first layer to obtain the nonlinear model in the second layer. Now what happens is some math. We have the input in the form x1, x2, 1, where the 1 comes from the bias unit. Now we multiply it by the matrix W1 to get these outputs. Then we apply the sigmoid function to turn the outputs into values between 0 and 1. Then the vector form of these values gets a 1 attached for the bias unit and multiplied by the second matrix. This returns an output that now gets thrown into a sigmoid function to obtain the final output, which is y hat. Y hat is the prediction or the probability that the point is labeled blue. So this is what neural networks do. They take the input vector and then apply a sequence of linear models and sigmoid functions. These maps, when combined, become a highly nonlinear map. And the final formula is simply y hat equals sigmoid of W2 combined with sigmoid of W1 applied to x. And just for redundance, we do this again on a multilayer perceptron or neural network. To calculate our prediction y hat, we start with a unit vector x, then we apply the first matrix and a sigmoid function to get the values in the second layer. Then we apply the second matrix and another sigmoid function to get the values on the third layer, and so on and so forth, until we get our final prediction, y hat. And this is the feedforward process that the neural networks use to obtain the prediction from the input vector.